Amen. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. As our call to worship today, let us stand and sing hymn 58, Bless the Lord, O My Soul. We'll sing the first verse.
Now it's time to wake up, amen?
Amen?
I believe y'all can sing better than that. I can't, but you can. It is good to see you this morning. It's good to be back, and I just want to thank you for your prayers. We had a, I guess you'd call it a personal mission trip the last week, and we're back. My wife is sick, but we're home safe and good to be back in the Lord's house on the Lord's day. And the first Sunday of a new year, so we welcome you this morning. Pray the Lord will speak to you. He'll encourage you this morning as we open the Word, as we worship together today. We want to welcome you. Thank you for coming and being a part of our service today. And may God bless you as you as we worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Larry, lead us in prayer, please, sir.
Our first hymn this morning is hymn 492, At Calvary.
Oh,
God for Calvary. Amen. Our next hymn number 572. We'll sing verses 1-3. Blessed Assurance.
Especially those on foreign soil that weren't able to be home during the holidays. Father, just continue to look after them, take care of them, protect them, and comfort them. Also, Father, we pray that you'll continue to take these tithes and offerings, use them to glorify thy name. For us in thy name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. Our offertory hymn today is hymn number 4, Praise the Savior. At this time, we'd like to invite Miss April to bring our special music tonight.
Thank you, April. This morning, I want to share with you from the book of Philippians, Philippians chapter number 3, and I'm going to invite you to turn there this morning. Philippians chapter number 3, beginning in verse number 10, and I want us to look at the life of Paul. Paul was probably the greatest Christian who ever lived. He wrote many of the books of the New Testament. He was a scholar, he was a Pharisee, Hebrew of the Hebrews, you name it, Paul was basically it. But Paul had a passion to know Christ. And that's what I want to look at this morning. So I invite you to stand with me as we read the scripture. Beginning verse number 10, Paul writes these words, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Not as though I'd already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but thus this one thing, forgetting those things which are behind, and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Let us therefore, as many as be perfect or mature, be thus minded, and if anything be otherwise minded, God shall reveal even this unto you. Father, I thank you today for your word that's able to change our hearts. And Lord, I pray that you'll speak to us. I pray that you'll minister to us. I pray that you would challenge us today. We ask these things now in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. It's a new year. It's a time of beginning again. Paul, in this letter, speaks to us about his heart. His heart that really desired God. Many of you are pursuing things in this new year. Maybe it's a college education. Maybe it's a new job. Maybe it's all kind of things. But the thing that I want to challenge you this morning is this. Will you pursue Jesus? That was Paul's heart. That was his desire. As we mentioned earlier, he's one of the greatest Christians who ever lived. He wrote all kind of things in this scripture. He talked to us about salvation, about how a man can be born again. He talked to us about sin and what sin is. He talked about the resurrection. You name it, Paul wrote about it. But then you come to this passage in Philippians, and Paul begins to pour out his heart about his pursuit, his desire for God. How is your desire this morning for God? Not for church. How is your desire for Jesus? See, a lot of people know about Jesus, but there's a difference between knowing about Jesus and knowing him. I mean, we could say a lot of people that we know about. Well, we know Abraham Lincoln. We know different people. But do we really know them? Paul said, my desire, my pursuit, my passion is to know him. Not just know things about him, but to know him intimately, because of who he is and what he has done. Paul said, I want to know him. I want to know who Jesus is in a greater way than I ever have in my life. Now, folks, think about this. This man has wrote all the doctrines in the New Testament. But yet, he wasn't satisfied with his walk with God. Too many times we become satisfied where we are spiritually. And we think, well, nobody can teach me anything. As a matter of fact, that was one of the issues he was dealing with in this passage. There were people who had come to the point in their life where they were just saying, well, you can't teach me nothing. I know it all. I'm perfect. It literally speaking of, I've come to the place spiritually where you can't teach me anything. When you get to that point in your life, you might as well just go on because nobody can say nothing to you. Do you see the humility in Paul? When he writes that I may know him. I want to know him intimately. Greater than I ever have before. I want to understand more about God. I want to obey him more. I want to serve him more. He said, I want to know him. And he said, I want to know the power of his resurrection. Now, he wasn't talking about the physical resurrection. What he was speaking about was the resurrection power that not only had raised Jesus up, but the power of God that had raised a sinner like Paul. Because the scripture says that you and I, when we are born, we are dead spiritually. And Paul says, I want to know, I want to understand this power of the resurrection that is able to raise someone who does not know God, who can convict this person of sin, who can draw them into the very presence of God so that they can know God. He said, I want to know this power. See, Paul understood power. Paul understood that probably the third greatest power in the world at that time was Rome, the nation of Rome. Second greatest power is sin because it binds man. It keeps man down. But the greatest power is the power of God that's able to do exceedingly above anything we can ask or say. That's the kind of power that Paul was talking about. He said, I want to know him. I want to know him. I want to know this resurrection power that is able to change a man or a woman that does not know God and that can change their heart so now there's a desire in their heart to love God with all of their heart. But he also is speaking about the fact that this power to overcome sin, this power to overcome trials and tribulations. He said, that's what I want to know. I want to know this resurrection power that God gives in life so that I can be the kind of person that God wants me to be. He said, that's what I want. I want to know him. I want to know the power of his resurrection. He said, not only that, but I want to know the fellowship of his sufferings. Now, he wasn't talking about the cross. Only God could suffer. Only Jesus could suffer as God for us on the cross and make us right with God. He wasn't talking about that. But what he was talking about was Jesus' daily walk with God. And as he loved God, and as he pursued God, how he obeyed God, and he was mocked. Many didn't want to follow him. He was persecuted. Now, if you look in the book of Corinthians, you'll see, 2 Corinthians, how Paul was stoned. He was beaten. He was in shipwreck. All these things happened to Paul, but Paul said, I want to know him even greater than that. I want to know this Jesus. And the fellowship, or the fellowship means the joint participation in this suffering that Jesus has gone through, because as I go through that, the power of the Holy Spirit of God is going to be upon me, and I'm going to see God work in my life. He said, that's what I want to know. I want to pursue God. I want him. I want to know him. I want to see the power of the resurrection being made conformable, he says, to his death. Now, he wasn't talking, again, he's not talking about physical death here. What was he talking about? He was talking about the kind of death where Paul speaks about the death to the self-life. Because God has to work out of us our independence. From the time we're born, we are taught to be independent. Do it yourself. Be a man, be a woman. But then when we're saved, what does God teach us? That we are to depend upon Him. So what God has to do in a man or a woman, boy or girl, is He's got to work out that independence so that we can depend upon Him. And that's what He is saying here, that we can be conformable to His death. If you look in chapter 2 of Philippians, you would find what theologians call the kenosis of God, which is the self-emptying of God, where God chose, the Lord Jesus Christ, chose to empty Himself to come and live and die and obey God so that we might have life and life everlasting. That's what Paul says, I want. He said, that's my pursuit. That's what I want in my life. That's pretty big, isn't it? But then he says, you know, this is what I want. But then he says, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Now again, he's not talking about being physically raised at the rapture. What he is speaking about is the fact that this resurrection power in him, that people will see God so working in his life that people see Jesus. It literally is as if he's around a bunch of corpses. They're all laying down, and he is standing up spiritually. And people are seeing what God is able to do in a man. That the power of God is able to raise this person up. That's what God does. He is able by His power to raise not only the dead physically, but He's able to raise those who are spiritually dead. That's what He said in Ephesians. And you who were dead in trespasses, God has raised. How? Through the power of the Holy Spirit. When He convicts us of sin, and we understand that we're a sinner and we're lost, and God draws us to Himself. So Paul says, listen, verse 12, he said, not as though I had already obtained. In other words, he's dissatisfied with his walk with God. How many today are dissatisfied with where you are spiritually? See, some people were just, I'm good. Paul said, no, I'm not good. I'm not satisfied where I'm at spiritually, because I want more than what I've got right now. And that would probably more than 99% of the people who've ever lived. But Paul said, I hadn't got there yet. I hadn't got to the point in my life spiritually where God cannot teach me, where the Spirit of God cannot speak to me in a way that draws me closer to Him. He said, I hadn't got there yet. I hadn't obtained that in my life right now. He said, not perfect. Again, some of the people there at Philippi thought that they had reach perfection. And see, there are churches today who say that once you're saved, you no longer sin. And I want to say, wake up. I mean, I don't know about you, but I'm tempted every day, aren't you? We're tempted every day. We sin every day. He said, Paul said, I haven't got there yet. I hadn't reached that state of where I no longer sin. But look what he says here. But I follow after. I follow, in other words, I'm pursuing with all of my heart. And it's a picture. There's actually two pictures. One's a picture of a runner who is running the race, trying to get to the mark. And the other is a picture of a person in a chariot. And the way the chariots were, it was basically two wheels and a board, and they were just moving. And Paul says, I follow after. Notice what he says here, what he is following. He said that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. Remember Paul's story? Remember the road to Damascus? What happened to Paul? Paul was pursuing Christians. He was putting them in jail. He was a Pharisee. That's what he was doing. He didn't love God. But on the road to Damascus, something happened. The Spirit of God touched his life. And Paul says, at that time, I was apprehended by Jesus Christ. And he said, now I want to apprehend Jesus in the same way he apprehended me. That's what I want to do in my life. I want to follow him. I want to search after him. I want to love him. I want to obey him. That's what I want to do in my life. He said, that's the dissatisfaction. But he said, I'm determined. Look at verse 13. He said, brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing. Now, if you look in your scripture, it says, I do. That's not actually in the original language. I do. When you see italics, that means it wasn't there. It just used for translation. He said, forgetting those things which are behind. Did you have any failures last year? Were there times that you didn't walk with God like you wanted to walk? Yeah. Were there times that things just didn't go right? And he goes on to say, you know, we're to forget those things that hindered us. Now, we're not going to forget them and totally get them out of our mind. But he said, you forget the things which are behind. In other words, you don't allow something that happened to you in the past to hinder your walk with God now. You're to forget those things. Because when you pray and you ask forgiveness, what does God do? God forgives. So what does he say? He says, forgetting those things which are behind, and reaching forth for those things which are before. Again, the aspect of someone who is straining with all of their might. They're pursuing with everything they have. They're trying to reach this destination. Now, understand what he is saying. He's not saying he's doing all this to get to heaven, folks. If you translate that, you've missed what he's trying to say. He is saying, I am pursuing all this because of what God wants for me right now. Someone said that the definition of being old is always looking to the past and never looking forward. Sometimes we live in the past. Paul said, nope. I'm gonna live in the. I'm stretching. I'm doing everything I can in my life to pursue God. He says, I'm pressing toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. He said, what I am doing, he said, I am pursuing God with everything I have. I'm stretching forth. I'm agonizing. I'm doing everything I can because I want Jesus. Not when I die. That's already been settled. That was settled long ago. But he said, I want it now. I want Jesus now in a greater way than I ever have before. How about you today? How about you? So you can pursue all kind of things. But understand this. The things we pursue many times here are temporal. You will not take them with you. The things that are eternal are the things of God. And those are the things that you'll take with you. What will you pursue this year? Will you pursue God? That's the challenge this morning. Will you pursue Him as you never have before? Will you obey Him like you never have before? Will you ask God to strengthen you so that people will see God in you? See, that's the application. The application is knowing Him and allowing God to transform our lives. Paul wrote in the book of Romans, that we, after we've been saved, that we are predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son. That's what Paul is talking about here, being conformed to the image of His Son. He wrote also in Romans, not to be conformed to the world, but be you transformed. See, that's what Paul is talking about. He's talking about transformation here, folks. How you obey God. How you pursue God. And what does God do? He transforms us into the very image of God. And when people see that, what do? They're to glorify God because of what God has done in that individual. Paul said, that's my pursuit. I'm pursuing Him because that's what I want in my life. I want God to be glorified in my life. There are many things this year that will challenge you. But the greatest challenge is what you'll do with Jesus. There's some of you here this morning and you've never trusted Jesus as your Lord and Savior. You know things about Jesus. You know He died on the cross. You know He lived 2,000 years ago. You know a lot of things about Him. But you don't know Him. And one day, you'll stand before God. And you'll have to give an account. What are you going to do with Jesus? What will you do with Him? For those who just know about Him. What does God want? He wants you to surrender your heart to Him. He wants to change you. He wants to make you who are dead in sin alive in Christ. You say, how does that happen? The Bible says it's so simple a child can understand it. Bible says we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. He says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And by placing your faith in Him, the Scripture says that you can be saved by trusting Him. That's what Paul says through the Scripture. You can become a child of God. There are others of you today, you're saved. But if you were honest with God, you'd have to say, I'm pursuing other things. You're pursuing the things of the world and you're really not pursuing Him. Will it change? Depends on you. Nobody can make you change. The Spirit of God can speak to you and He can encourage you. But you will have to make the decision on how you will walk this year with God. There are others, and you're walking with God. But Could there be more? I'm not saying working, okay? Don't misunderstand me. You can't work for your salvation. You can't do that. But you can honor Him by the way you live. By surrendering, by obeying Him. By saying to Him, Lord, not my will, but yours. In just a moment, we're going to have an invitation hymn. And maybe you're here this morning and you've never trusted Him as your Lord and Savior. You've never walked with Him. I want to encourage you today. Would you give your life to Him? Would you say, Lord, I want you to come into my life and change me? And He will do that. And there's others of you this morning. Maybe you just need to come to the altar and say, God, this year, I'm going to pursue you. I'm going to walk with you in a way that I've never had before. That's the desire of my heart. In just a moment, we're going to have an invitation to Him. And I want to encourage you as God speaks to you to make the decision that is pleasing unto Him. Would you stand with me, please? Father, I thank you today. Father, for your word. Father, for the testimony of Paul. And Lord, I pray that, Lord, you'll speak to lives. Lord, you know each person here this morning. You know who they are. Lord, you know their spiritual condition. And God, I pray this morning for those who are lost. God, would you speak to them? Would you draw them through the power of the Holy Spirit, God, to you today? And Lord, there are others here today that are saved. But they're really not walking with you. Just doing their own thing. God, would you convict them? Lord, would you convict us in a way that, Lord, that will break us for the glory of God? So that we'll be the people that you want us to be. So that we'll walk with you, that we'll obey you. Father, I pray, Lord, for your perfect will to be done. Father, we ask these things now in Jesus' name and for His sake. If you need to come this morning while we sing this invitation, you come this morning.
Our hymn of invitation is 488, Just As I Am.
To speak to us, encourage us through His word. Let's pray together and ask the Lord's blessing upon our time together this morning. And by the way, Happy New Year. Father, thank you so much for the day you've blessed us with. And Lord, to be able to be back in your house, what a joy and a privilege it is. Father, I thank you and I praise you today. Thank you for each person that's here this morning. Pray that you'll continue to speak to us and draw us to yourself. We ask these things now in Jesus' name. Amen.